Good morning. Welcome home, everyone. We are so happy that you've chosen to join us this morning. I would like to share some announcements. This Monday, or tomorrow, our prayer chain will gather here at 10:30 a.m. to have a prayer meeting. This Tuesday, we will have our Women's Ministry Home League at 10 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall. Don't forget to join us. On Wednesday, we have our Sisters, Inc. Bible Study at 5 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall and through Zoom. For more information, reach out to Lieutenant Eleni Posner. You can reach her at 530-889-3990, extension 215. Once again, welcome home and blessings.
Good morning. My name is Damian Horn. It's good to be here to worship with you all again. If you'd like to stand when we sing, you're welcome to. If you want to sit down anytime, you're free to do that as well.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Yeah. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. How you would take my place. How you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquers the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquers and grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, 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 oh. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Yeah. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me. All that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. And you unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song.
We're singing No Longer Slaves.
Of deliverance from my enemies. Till all my fears are gone, and I'm no longer a slave to fear, and I am a child of God. No, I'm no longer a slave to fear, and I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you've chosen me. Your love has called my name. And I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. No, I'm no longer a slave to fear. And I am a child of God. No, I'm no longer a slave to fear. And I am a child of God. No, I'm no longer a slave to fear. And I am a child of God. No, I'm no longer a slave to fear, and I am a child of God. And I am surrounded by the arms of the Father, and I am surrounded by songs of deliverance, 'cause we've been liberated from our bondage. We're the sons and the daughters. Let us sing our freedom, yeah. Oh, 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 oh. So I could walk right through it. My fears are drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of God. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. Drowned in perfect love. You're asking me so I could stand and say, I am a child of God. 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 And I'm no longer a slave to fear. And I am a child of God. No, I'm no longer a slave to fear. And I am a child of God. And be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence, my life. Be thou my wisdom, and thou my true word. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, and I thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou art my only, first in my heart. My King of heaven, my treasure, how I. The high King of heaven, my victory won. May I reach heaven, joy, O heaven's Son. The heart of vision, O ruler of all. Still be my vision, O ruler of all. There's nothing worth more, heaven'll ever come close. No thing can compare, Tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Yes, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness, Lord. So Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. It's your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
God, as the psalmist writes, that there is no place that we can run to that you are not there. So God, our invitation is not one of, you know, that you're not here. God, it's that we would humble ourselves to your presence, God, to what you're doing. God, and may we be not be the same because of it. May we be changed and be different because of what you are doing in our midst. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You guys can be seated.
Good morning. We will now have a time of worship through offering. And I just want to share this verse as an encouragement as well before I pray. And it can be found in 2 Timothy 1, verse 7. And it says, "For God did not give us a spirit of timid or cowardice or fear, but he has given us a spirit of power and of love and of sound judgment and personal discipline, abilities that result in a calm, well-balanced mind and self-control." Amen. And so as we enter in this time of giving, I just want to encourage you and remind you that our help comes from the Lord and that he is our provider. Amen. And also, when you guys come up here, if you can please walk through the outside of the aisles, because our live stream is in the center, and that way we don't want you to accidentally trip over the camera. And just please join me in prayer. Dear Lord, I just thank you for another day that you've given us. I thank you for your faithfulness. I thank you that we get this opportunity to just come together and be able to give back to you, Lord. And I just ask that you bless this time and you bless this offering. In your name I pray. Amen.
Stand as I read the scripture today, found in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. I solemnly charge you before God in Christ Jesus, who is going to judge the living and the dead, and because of his appearing and his kingdom, proclaim the message, persist in it whether convenient or not. Rebuke, correct, and encourage with great patience and teaching, for the time will come when they will not tolerate sound doctrine, but according to their own desires will multiply teachers for themselves, because they have an itch to hear something new. They will turn away from hearing the truth and will turn aside to myths. But as for you, be serious about everything. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry. This is the word of God for the army of God. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, welcome home, everyone, and good morning. It's just so awesome today. We have our core cadets pretty much running the service. So I praise God for them, you know. I just want to give them a round of applause. They're doing the live stream, the media. They're making sure it's actually streaming. It's amazing. They're doing the welcome. And if you don't know what our core cadets is, it's our discipleship program for young adults and teens. And it's a discipleship program that, you know, just helps them grow in their relationship with Christ and also step up into leadership positions, not only in the church, but helps them do this in life as well. That's the goal. So I praise God for them, and I'm glad that they can help us today. So today, as we read in 2 Timothy 4, 1 through 5, I know it says 1 through, I think it said 1 through 4, but it was 1 through 5. That we're going to be talking about today. And I'm calling it sugar-coated. Sugar-coated. And I know I posted this cartoon that many of you see. I know that on live stream you can't see it, but I'll post it later. I'll get it on for you later. But it was on social media. It's a really cool cartoon that has a little preacher up there saying, God is madly in love with you. His universe revolves around you. God's not angry with sin. Warm and fuzzies. And then the crowd is saying, yes, tell us pleasant things. And then it has part of the passage that we read. And I have a little quote that I put there. Sugarcoating the message of God is dangerous to your soul. It is dangerous. Very dangerous. And I'm today wanting to sum up and bring to a close our sermon series called Renewing, Not Redoing. And this has a big impact on God's renewing powers. When the church does not want to hear his message, and they only want to hear the warm and fuzzies, when they just want the sugar-coated gospel, when they would rather, instead of have the message, have a massage, there's problems. And you may be thinking to yourself, but Jesse, sugar's great. Sugar's awesome. I love sugar. But when it comes to the truth, but when it comes to God's word, we must not sugarcoat it, no matter how difficult or how hard it may seem, because it's going to cause problems. When it comes to new, when you think about it, new things, it's hard. It's sometimes uncomfortable. It's sometimes scary. The truth of Christ must not be sugarcoated, though. It must not be watered down. It must be delivered as is. And done so clearly. And truth, with truth. It's all rainbows and sunshine should not be what you teach. And it should not be what I'm teaching. It should not be what you're sharing. Because if we share this to people that become Christians, or share it to new believers and make them think, oh, it's all rainbows and sunshine, it's all gumdrops and butterflies. When you're a Christian, everything goes right, everything's nice. God would never harm or allow harm, should I say allow harm, to happen to his people. It doesn't matter what you're doing. Do what you want. You're the people of God. If you do that, you'll see people dropping like flies in the faith. You'll see people leaving the faith and turning their back on God, because right when the storm picks up, when something negative happens, when they have a little bit of uncomfortableness, or they have an area that's unknown or scary, they'll be like, whoa, whoa, I thought it was all rainbows and sunshine. I thought being a Christian was perfect, perfect life, easy life, sugary life. I'm done with this. I had it easier in the world. Nothing can be renewed. Nothing can be renewed when you don't hear the full truth, the full message. You won't be able to grow. You just have to think about it that way. If you don't tell somebody everything, they can't fully complete the task. If I have an employee and I tell them part of what I want done, they won't do it the way I asked them to, because I didn't tell them the whole story. We have to give the full message, or we will not grow. We have to take in the full message, or we will not grow. We have to share the full message, or the kingdom of God will not grow, and nothing new. We will hinder the renewing power of God, because his church just wants sugar-coated truth. Sugar is good, but it also rots your teeth. So sugar-coating the gospel rots your soul. And we need to remember that. And when you accept the call of Christ on your life, you will have to, and I will jump right back into the passage here. In verse 2, it says, proclaim the message, persist in it, whether convenient or not, rebuke, correct, encourage with great patience and teaching. When you accept the call on your life, when you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and he is the master of your life, when he is your Savior, your Messiah, your King, you must proclaim the message. You must persist in it, whether convenient or not. Rebuke, correct, and encourage with great patience and teaching. And that's not going to be easy. That's not going to be easy. You see, what's going on here in this passage is Paul is developing Timothy. He's discipling one of his young adults. Timothy was young. We know in the letters to Timothy, it's talking about don't let them despise you for your youth. Remember who taught you the scriptures when you were growing up. Remember the family you came from. Remember what I taught you. Remember the faith you have and what you know about scripture. He's encouraging him. He's saying, you need to drive out the false teachers. You need to make sure that it's going to be hard. And I know this is new to you, but you just need to keep pushing forward. You need to keep proclaiming. You need to keep rebuking and correcting and encouraging. It's going to be hard, but you can do it. You need to persist in it. And he's encouraging Timothy, a young adult who is now in this new leadership position. He is at a church over there. I wish I wrote down exactly what church that was. Oh, my goodness. But I'll get it to you. But he's at the church, and he is faced with all these trials and storms and issues. And these people are starting to, you know, oh, who are you to tell me what? You're like, what, 18? You're real young. How can you help me with my life? How can you help me with my walk? Or people coming in going, oh, this is how we've always done it. When I was worshiping at that temple, this is what we did, so why can't we do it here? But he has to say, no, that's not the message of Christ. That's not how we're going to do it here. And it may have ruffled some feathers. It may have disappointed some people. It may have made him not as popular. But guess what? He's not to sugarcoat it. He's supposed to deliver it, and he's supposed to deliver it straightforward with them. The world needs this message more than ever, not a massage. The world needs the message that the Bible gives, the gospel of Christ, not a massage. And that's all I've been seeing lately in our culture today, is we're just rubbing the backs of each other. It's all right. You did what? Oh, it's fine. God's not angry with sin. Warm and fuzzies. That's what I see people doing. And it reminded me of a story found in the Bible, of course, in Genesis 12, where Abraham leaves his home. He was 75 when God called him and said, hey, I'm going to show you a place. I want you to leave your home, and I'm going to show you a place. I'm going to make you a great nation, and I want to show you a place, and I'm going to take you that's going to be amazing. That's pretty much what he was told. He wasn't given blueprints. He wasn't given a GPS map. He wasn't told in detail, like an op order in the military where it goes down the terrain, the enemy, the mission, their equipment. He didn't have any of that. God was like, you know what? I know you're living great here in Mesopotamia, but I want you to leave everything you know, take your family, and go over there, because I'm going to do great things. I'm going to do new things with you. Oh, okay, God. But we do know from the passage in Genesis 12, in that chapter, he actually does. He gets his family, he gets his things, he even gets his nephew, Lot, and they leave. They knew what was at stake, but they followed God. It was a hard truth. Okay, I'm here, I'm living good. I'm in a huge city, I have everything I want. I can go down to the grocery store and pick up whatever I want. There's ATMs there. I have neighbors that I can borrow stuff from. You know, this is great. I have a really great job. I'm getting paid really, really well. And now you want me to just get up and go to some place I don't know with my whole family, and we could die on the road, we can be robbed, I may not get a job, I don't know how I'm going to provide for my family where I'm going, because you haven't really told me where I'm going, you want to show me. So, and imagine him having this conversation with his wife, Sarah. I don't think he sugarcoated, I think he said, God told me we have to go. He didn't sugarcoat it. The Bible's silent on it, but I'm assuming he didn't sugarcoat it. He told her straight, and she accepted it as well, and they left. But imagine what he was leaving, because he's leaving a big town. He was leaving a big, built-up area that had everything he needed. He was living good, and he was 75. He wasn't 20. He wasn't an entrepreneur trying to just make it on his own, single, bachelor. No, he had established life. But God wanted to do something new. And he didn't sugarcoat it. And then when we read in the chapter, famine hit. And I'm not going to get all into that, but famine hit, and he had to go to Egypt to get some supplies and everything on the way when he was traveling. But do you think about it? I've been told by God very vaguely where he wants me to go, because he wants me to trust him. So I'm going in this way. I'm going somewhere. I don't know if I'm going to be able to feed my family. I don't know if I'm going to have a job. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know where I'm going to live. I don't know if we're going to get robbed. I don't know. But I'm going to trust God. because he wants to do something new, and he's never let me down. But then famine hits. But wait, God, I thought I was doing what you wanted. I thought you asked me to go here. Why is it not warm and fuzzy? I thought it was going to be good. I'm listening to you. What's going on? Just think about that for a while. Imagine if he just wanted to stay in what he was used to. If he just wanted the sugar-coated life that he was living. Would there be Israel? Would there be the people of God? The world needs the message of Christ. The world needs the message, the revelation of God, not a massage. We need to do the work of an evangelist and proclaim the message. And when I was stuck in addiction, when I was drinking myself to death, I too was sugarcoating my problems. I had no power to get over this on my own. Every time I tried to get out of addiction or to stop drinking, I would maybe stop for a month or so and fall right back into it, causing more problems. I had to surrender to Christ because I had to admit and surrender and say that, you know what, I'm wrong. You know what's right, Lord. I don't have the strength. I need your strength, Lord. I need your guidance because my guidance is taking me down into a pit. When I finally surrendered to God, I came to Eleni, and of course Eleni doesn't believe because we kept going on this back and forth, you know, oh, I'm better, I'm not going to do drugs and alcohol anymore, you know, I'm fine, and then I would. So she didn't believe me. I had to trust God. I had to leave what I knew. I had to leave what I understood and what I could control, even though I was failing at it. And I had to go to a rehab that the military put me in, and I had to trust that my family would still be there when I got back. I had to trust in the Lord that I'm doing the right thing because I'm surrendering to you. I can't do it anymore. I don't know what's beyond this decision. I don't know what I'm about to get myself into. I don't know what's in store for me. I don't know if my family is going to be waiting for me and believing me, but I'm going to trust in you, Lord, because my sugar-coated life that I'm trying to sugarcoat all my problems with is rotting my soul and rotting everything around me. Imagine if I kept sugarcoating my problems because that's what I was doing. Oh, you know, I don't need to stop drinking. I just need to drink less. I don't need to really stop this. I just need to figure out a way to control it. I don't have a problem. Everyone drinks a few. Everyone drinks maybe a beer once a day. Everyone does this. I was sugarcoating and condoning my issues instead of realizing, like, no, I have a problem. And I'm killing myself. And everyone around me. Imagine if I kept sugarcoating my problems. I would not have a family. I might even be dead. The world needs God's message. The world needs his redemption that we get through Jesus Christ. The world needs the message, not a massage. Do the work of an evangelist. Proclaim the message. The warm and fuzzies, it does not help anything. Before I get into more of what I really want you guys to get from this today, is I just want to share a big example is social media. I know I'm using it right now to get this service out, but there's so many times I'm going onto social media and there'll be somebody that is upset because they disagree with somebody else or they posted something that ruffled their feathers and instead of discussing it with the person, calling them, you know, having a constructive criticism, you know, back and forth kind of thing, no, what they do is they're kind of passive aggressive and what they do is they want sugar, so to speak, sprinkled all over them. So what do? They go to their page and they post like, how dare they do this? How dare they do that? And I can't believe this. And then guess what? All their sugar-coating friends, the candy-making friends that they have around them, start stroking their back, giving them a massage. Oh, you're so correct. How dare they? How selfish of them. Oh my goodness, you are so right. Yeah, preach it, brother. Preach it, sister. And they're just getting a massage from all their friends that are on social media. Or if you want to keep the sugar-coated analogy, it's candy makers sprinkling sugar all over them, going, yes, you are right. And that person does not grow, does not get out of their bad habit. They feel that, oh, I can be passive-aggressive. I can shun other people. I can cause division because look at all the people that agree with me. Look at all the people that think that it's good. We should not be surrounding ourselves with people that only agree with us. We should be surrounding ourselves with a mixture of people that believe what we believe and don't, that agree with us politically and spiritually and don't, so that we are able to give a defense for the hope we have, so that we can share really well, so that we can have a strong foundation, and that we can try to bring this unity and show the world that there is a better way to do it, and that God's message may be hard, it may have some uncertainties in the mortal life, but we have assurance of Jesus Christ and the redemption and that he has given us through his sacrifice, and we know where we're going to go when we leave this place. But we can't be like the social media people that just want people to give them a massage. Oh, and then, well, and how dare you if you do give them constructive criticism? How dare you? How dare you? That's how they act. How dare you say something? And it reminded me of Jeremiah. The way people are on social media, sugarcoating everything, just wanting the massage instead of a message, they reminded me of Jeremiah. And we find this in Jeremiah 23, verses 16 through 17. Jeremiah 23, verses 16 through 17. The whole chapter is amazing. You guys should read that whole, I mean, the whole book is, but 16 through 17. This is what the Lord of hosts says. Do not listen to the words of the prophets who prophesy to you. They are making you worthless. They speak visions from their own minds, not from the Lord's mouth. They keep on saying to those who despise me, the Lord has said you will have peace. They have said to everyone who follows the stubbornness of his heart, no harm will come to you. Does that remind you of anything going on today? Jeremiah was one of the only prophets in the area he was in telling them, no, you guys better turn back. God has told me that if you don't stop sacrificing children, false worship, sexual immorality, all this stuff, if you don't stop all your sin, worshiping Baal, if you don't stop it, he's going to give you over to Babylon. He's going to let you go into exile. He's going to destroy this and push you out of the promise. And then there was these other prophets, you know, they were the ones on social media going, oh, no, you're right. Have this massage. You're good. Don't listen to Jeremiah. He's cuckoo. He's crazy. One guy, look at us. We have like 50 of us prophesying that there's peace. God's not going to exile you. You're good to go. Keep sinning. It's all right. God will forgive you. You're the people of God. Why would he do anything to you? Why would he allow punishment, judgment? He's a just God, but not to you. You guys get out. Look at us. We're 50 saying that. That's one person saying the opposite. But only one was preaching the message, not giving a massage. Only one was giving it to them straight, not sugarcoating it and making it so that they condoned their sin and were just going to go off into judgment. And when you think about it here, it's not only the pastor. It's not only the person giving the message. It's not only the one that's leading the church or leading the Bible study that this affects or that we should be mindful about sugarcoating. It is every single Christian. If you say that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior, you better be giving the message straight. Because we are told to make disciples of all nations. All of us are. We are told to be God's hands and feet. We are told to share his love and forgiveness. But if we're not giving the message straight, if we're not giving it to them to where they fully understand the gravity of their actions and why they truly, truly, truly need a Savior, they're going to be like, oh, I'm fine. It doesn't sound that bad. It sounds like it's just a little slap on the wrist. I'm going to keep doing what I'm doing. Just like what happened in Jeremiah, where he was trying to warn them and everyone else was saying, no, it's not that big of a deal. We would rather hear what sounds good, the itching ear. We would rather hear what lets us stay the same. We would rather hear things that teach us that I don't have to change, I don't have to do anything new, I can stay in this comfort, than having to do something difficult. That's what we would rather hear. So that's why as Christians, we better be careful on what we are preaching, what we are teaching, and how we are delivering the word of God, because we could be just leading someone astray like those other prophets that were giving false testimony of what God really was telling them. God wanted to do something new in the life of Israel, but first they had to learn, since they were not allowing the renewing because of their stuck in their way attitude. And the church is falling into that now. We are getting stuck in the ways we've done things. We are not allowing God to renew us because it's going to be more difficult. I have to learn a new way to do it. I have to change this in my life. I have to upgrade that or buy this or spend money here. Or I have to move away from what I know. I have to go to another country. I have to go to another town. I got to go speak to that person that I'm scared of. If we're not allowing this, and we are allowing those fears to take control of us, we will start to try to sugarcoat our problems and go, well, I'm doing God's work right here. Why go out there? There's people coming here. Why do I have to talk to that person? Someone else will talk to them. I'm busy helping my neighbor that lives right next door to me, and that's as far as I'll go. However you want to sugarcoat it, however you want to condone it, oh, you know, God will forgive me. We have to stop doing that. We can't be stuck in our ways. We have to allow something new. Just hearing that itching ear feeling, allowing to hear what we want, is not going to help us. It's not going to help us. Right there in Isaiah 30:10, Isaiah talks about the same thing. The people just want to hear pleasing things. And I'm sorry, but you're not going to get that from me. I used to, you would think that I don't want to ruffle someone's feathers. I think, you know, they may get upset if I tell them this. They may not be my friend anymore, whatever the case may be. But the gravity of what's happening to this world, the gravity of people watering down the gospel of Christ and saying they are Christians but living as if they are not a Christian, but, it's okay, and sugarcoating all their problems and condoning it and hearing the people the same, it's okay. God will forgive you no matter what. I mean, Paul addressed it many, many times. Just because God will forgive it doesn't mean you should keep doing it. So let's stop sugarcoating it. You know, a lot of times we read this. We read stuff about Jeremiah. We read stuff about Paul. We read stuff about Isaiah. We read stuff about the early church and the early church fathers and everything, and we admire them. Man, they are powerful leaders. Oh, this is great. But we like to admire them from afar, because it's too uncomfortable. It's too unknown. I don't want to deal with what they dealt with. I like to admire them and go, yeah, I'm a Christian. And I hide behind their fame, I guess you can say, of Paul. We'd like to admire them from afar like a bear in a cage, because I don't dare let the bear out of the cage, because then I have to deal with it. Then I have to deal with the scariness. I have to deal with the unknown. We have to stop admiring the heroes of the faith and start acting like them. We have to stop admiring them from afar and figuring out how I can apply what they have done in my life today for this generation. Because if I don't, I'm sugarcoating the message of God. We have to call it what it is and point people in the right direction. And the thing that came to mind was someone driving off a cliff. Now, this may be an extreme example, but if you're in the car and someone was driving towards a cliff, you wouldn't calmly tell them, oh, hey, you might not want to drive to that cliff. You know, it could hurt. It'll be a little bit unpleasant, I think, you know. But, I mean, if you want to, you know, I don't want to make you mad. If you want to drive that way, it's fine, but you know, it could hurt. Might hurt you. No, I doubt we would do that. I think if we saw a friend and we were in the car and they were driving towards a cliff, we would be like, what are you doing? Stop the car. I don't want to die. Do you want to die? We'd give it to them straight because we understand the gravity of what's about to happen. If we truly understand the gravity of our souls and what's at stake, why won't we do the same? People may be thinking right now, well, what about sharing it in love? You can share it in love and still rebuke somebody. You can be loving and correct someone. You can be loving and give it to them straight. You can be loving and pray for those that are hard to pray for. You can be loving and talk to those that are hard to talk and have confrontations. Because guess what? An argument to confrontation is not really bad. It's how you deal with it when you're in that argument or confrontation which makes it good or bad. You should be able to have a discussion. You should be able to disagree with somebody and try to point them on the right path. Think about Jesus. He gives us great examples of this. He saw he was with the woman that was caught committing adultery. He made sure, hey, you guys don't have that condemning attitude. You should not condemn her, pretty much. This is me summing it, paraphrasing. Don't condemn her because you guys are sinning too. You know, he said that, if any of you have no sin, throw the first stone. They all left, but what did he do? Did he just go, oh, and you're good to go? No, he said, go and sin no more to the woman. He confronted it. He was direct. He didn't go, oh, you might want to not do that or you'll end up in this situation again. But, no, I don't want to tell you how to live your life. You know, it's okay. No, he said, go and sin no more. Don't do it. I'm not going to condemn you. I forgive you, but don't do it no more. When he talked to Peter, and Peter was like, oh, I'm not going to let them take you, Lord. He said, behind me, Satan. Imagine if I told one of you guys disagreed with me, and I said, behind me, Satan. You'd probably leave this church and never come back. But Peter stuck to it. He understood, oh, man, I can't, I got to take it with a grain of salt, but I need to learn from this. Christ told me, just behind me, Satan. Okay, so let me learn from this. What am I missing here? And he learned from his mistake, and he is the rock that the church was built on. He is one of the close disciples. Imagine if he was like, oh, behind me, Satan. No, you didn't just say that, Jesus, and just walk out and be like, I'm done. I was ready to die for you, but okay, you want them to take you? I'm done. I'm going to go back to what I was doing. And we do know that he had a moment of that, but that's because he denied Christ and he felt guilty. But Christ came to him, renewed him, and he allowed the renewing. But we can correct people and it'd be okay. We can rebuke people and it'd be okay. We can be direct and it'd be okay. But we need to do it. The world needs the message of God, not a massage. So what will we do? What will we do? You know, I was reading this for the Bible study that we did last Wednesday, and it really hit home. Paul is talking to the Galatian church, and in verse 10, he says, "For am I now trying to win the favor of people or God? Or am I striving to please people? If I were still trying to please people, I would not be a slave of Christ, a servant of God." Do you get what he's saying? If you want the world to like you, don't be a Christian. If you want the world to love you and you want to fit in and you want everything to go smoothly, or you think it's going smoothly when everything's falling apart. I thought things were going smoothly too, but I was losing my family. My life was rotting. If that's what you want, then don't be a Christian. Because that's what Paul's saying here in Galatians 1:10. He said, if I wanted to please man, then I would not be a servant of Christ, because it's not going to be that way. That's why he told Timothy that he needs to persist. He needs to keep doing it. He needs to rebuke. He needs to correct. He needs to give the message to the people in truth. He needs to give it to them fully. Not just the good part, but also the condemnation part that could happen. Why do I need Jesus? Because there's judgment. Because of my sin. So what will we do? What will we do? We need to be a people that allows the renewing of God to flow through us into this broken world. But will we let him? Or will we continue to sugarcoat our problems and push his truth away because I'd rather get the massage that everyone I've surrounded myself with is giving me? Will we be stuck in our old ways? Or will we want to go back to Egypt, so to speak? Will we want to go back to our old self, our old life, because it's just too hard? Or I don't want to do that one uncomfortable thing? Will you continue to sugarcoat your problems and walk blindly into judgment, exile, or even worse? The message is clear. God wants to use us for his glory, to share his love, to share his forgiveness, to bring about redemption through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. That's what he wants us to do. He wants us to put in the work of an evangelist, as we would call it nowadays. He wants us to be those disciplers. He wants us to be those that are teaching others. He wants us to be his hands and feet, but we cannot do it if we're only giving part of the message out, or if we're downplaying it or watering it down or sugarcoating it. People will go into exile. Will we just continue to teach others what feels good to us and not what they need to hear? And so right now, as the music plays and as we pray, I want to let everyone know that this whole sermon series, I was trying to direct us all to a turning point that we are at in the road because of what the world is turning into. We would rather hear what we want instead of deal with it. I would rather hear what I want instead of changing something in my life, because that's hard. I would rather just ignore and not talk to anyone and just allow division, because I don't want to have this constructive conversation with somebody and build bridges so that they too can accept Christ. We are at this turning point in the road that maybe if we just turn right towards God, maybe our children and our grandchildren and our grandchildren's children will go that way. And we can bring so much more to the kingdom of God. But if we turn to the left, if we turn towards the sugarcoating, if we turn towards the watered-down gospel, and that's what we share, generations yet still unborn right now will curse our names for having been unfaithful to God and his word. Or when we're in heaven, I don't know how it's going to be when we're at the judgment seat, and then we look over and there's a past generation right there, and they're getting sentenced to hell because, and they look to me and say, why didn't you teach me the full truth? I don't know if that's what we're going to be confronted with at the judgment seat, but imagine being confronted with that. Why didn't you share this with me? They will curse our names for having been unfaithful to God and his word. So I challenge everyone today, everyone watching, I challenge us all, even myself, to learn from the examples that are here in the Bible and from those that have gone before us in the faith. Be a people of renewing, not redoing. And preach the full message of Christ. Let's give it to the Lord right now in prayer and ask him to give us this strength so that we won't be sugar-coated messengers, but we'll be bold, on fire, kingdom-building servants of God. If you're here and you want prayer, please come up here and receive prayer. I'll pray with you. If you've accepted the Lord Jesus as your Lord and Savior today, message, call us. Don't leave here today without getting prayer and finding out what that means and getting plugged into a church family. It's going to be hard, but we need to push forward. We need to give the message. So when you go out today, be like Abraham and walk by faith. You may not have the whole message, you may not have the whole plan, but you need to trust God and do what's hard and do what's uncomfortable, and don't just try to sit in your sugar-coated life or wherever you're at where you feel comfortable. We need to step out of our comfort zone like Abraham did. We need to step into the unknown and the uncertain. Even though I had certainty in Christ, I had to do when I went to rehab. We need to do this. Let's do that. Let's do that as a body of Christ. Let's do that as a church. Let's stop turning to the people that would give us that massage, the itching ear, as the passage talks about. Let's be a people of renewing, not redoing. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you now. We can't thank you enough that you have given it to us straight. In your word, in the Bible, you have given us both do's and don'ts. You've given us hard truths. The more I study your word, the more I realize there's things that I just can't believe they've done that. I can't believe they don't see it. I can't believe I'm allowing it in my life. All these things that we see that you have given us, because you have given it to us straight, you have tried to tell us multiple different ways. May we accept the correction. May we accept the encouragement. May we accept the rebuke. Learn from it. Allow the new thing to be done through us so that we can be that true city on a hill, that light, that beacon of hope that brings the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ to a world that is broken and that is so stuck in a sugar-coated mentality where they feel that they're doing great when they are just rotting away. I pray that you give us strength and wisdom as we navigate this world. I pray this in Jesus' name. We all pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.